Neiman, Brian Wilson, Mary Catherine Hamm, today's newsmakers, and you, the Morning Majority. 105.9 FM. AM 630. WMAL.
7:37 on the Morning Majority, 105.9 FM. Yes, I said FM and AM 630 WMAL. It's Brian Wilson. Hamm and Neiman are taking the day off. Major Garrett is here helping us get through the 4 hours. And, of course, we're joined this morning at this time after a big Redskins game by Trevor Maddich, former Redskin and analyst on ESPN. Trevor, it's good to have you with us.
Great to be here.
Hey, listen, the Redskins won. They are 3-1. Who would have thunk it?
Yeah, who would have thunk it?
Well, I thunk it because I said they're going to win 10 games.
You said they were going to win 10, and you're right on the horse now.
I'll tell you what, I think it's going to happen. I'm feeling good about this, but they looked pretty good yesterday.
Yeah, they did.
And but, I mean, also we have to say the Rams look pretty bad.
Yeah, the Rams right now might struggle to win the SEC, the College Football Conference. Actually, no, that's not true. But, yeah, the Rams are one of the worst teams in the league right now, and so we would have learned more about the Redskins had they lost this game.
By the way, I have to stop you here.
Than winning it.
Because I have to say this. This is required by law.
Shoot.
The Redskins Report is presented to you by Fork Union Military Academy. Now continue your thought.
Nice. But they took care of business in most areas. They did well in most areas. They ran the ball well, as they were expected to do.
Yeah.
So it's good for them to play a team that's struggling like the Rams to get some rhythm of their own.
Who should run the ball? Do the Redskins stick with Tim Hightower, or do they go with the star of yesterday's game, Ryan Terrain?
See, Major, that's a great question, because for the first time in a long time, the Redskins have choices at running back.
We have riches of blessings.
That's right. In the past, it's been Clinton Portis and nobody else. So there hasn't been competition where they've pushed each other to get better. Well, now you've got three guys, including a young rookie, who are capable of doing it. Roy Helu Jr. And you're right about Ryan Terrain. He missed the entire preseason almost because of injury.
Right.
And now he's got his first significant action in this game. And he ran with violence.
Yeah, he was awesome yesterday.
It was fantastic. I mean, when tacklers came up on him, he didn't just try to miss or slip the tackle. He tried to punish the tackler. It was a beautiful thing.
Running under your shoulder pads, I believe, is the expression.
Yeah, and through the other guy's shoulder pads.
Yeah. Okay, now tell me about Rex Grossman. I mean, I thought he looked fairly good. There were a couple of what I would have to say are bad throws, one interception late in the game.
Yeah, there were two interceptions. One was
not his fault.
Moss's fault. It went off of his hands, and it was a good throw. The second one was late in the game, which gave the Rams a chance to tie this game. And it was a really terrible throw. It was a play-action pass. He didn't see the middle linebacker drop underneath the route and threw the ball right to the middle linebacker. And I actually asked him on the postgame show on Comcast Sportsnet about the passing game, and he bristled. He wasn't really happy about the question because they won the game. But the truth of it is, Grossman only completed 51% of his passes. And he threw a couple of those away, so that's not all on him. But on a day when you face a terrible defense, when you run the ball 40 times and only throw it 29, so that the defense is focused on the running game,
right,
you should have a much higher completion percentage than that. And so it'll be interesting to see in their film study what they need to improve, because that's the one area that I think that they really didn't do as well as they should have.
I thought he looked pretty good, actually, but I mean, overall, but there was, you know, there's always that question about the interception with Grossman.
Well, you're right about that. And he did do well. And other than that one just big bonehead throw at the end, he did protect the ball well. But this is the thing he's got to overcome. He's got to overcome the perception of a critical situation, and he makes a bonehead play after playing well or relatively well the rest of the game.
What do we remember?
That's right.
And we've got to buy the Redskins. I'm not a big Redskins fan. I don't wish them ill. I just grew up in San Diego, and I love my hometown Chargers. Bye week for the Redskins, then the Eagles, then the Panthers, then Buffalo on the road, and then San Francisco. Those next four games, first of all, what happens in a bye week? These kind of things you're talking about, did they get addressed first and foremost during the bye week as far as the quarterback and sorting out Hightower, Terrain, Roy Helu?
Major, that's one of the two things they usually do during a bye week, is figure out what problems need to be addressed and how to improve those. And I think the completion percentage is one of those. Another thing they do is get back to fundamentals. It's almost like training camp in some ways, where they don't have to game plan for a team in that first week. And so they just start practicing once again the blocking and the tackling, the fundamentals that you tend to lose as you get into game planning because your focus tends to shift. But more than anything else, you're trying to rejuvenate. You're trying to rest. You're trying to use that time to mentally and physically become whole. And one of the great things about winning going into the bye week is that you feel good about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you know, otherwise you've got 2 weeks of abject misery. You guys, losing a football game the next week at an NFL football complex, the week of practice and meetings, it's miserable. If you lose two in a row, the following week is almost unbearable because of the pressure that's out there
right.
to win. Because you don't win, it's more likely that you won't have a job.
I want to go back to the game yesterday and Sam Bradford.
Yeah, poor guy.
This guy's got a lot of talent.
Yeah.
I mean, he really has some ability. It's just too bad there's no team around him.
Yeah, that's the problem. When you're that good, you're the number one pick in the draft, you go to the team that was bad enough to get the number one pick in the draft.
That's right.
And so...
And the Steven Jackson injury is huge. I mean, that's made an enormous difference in putting so much more pressure on Sam Bradford.
Sure, and then they had injuries with the wide receivers as well. And so the Redskins' defense didn't worry about getting burned downfield by talented receivers. There were injuries there. They weren't as worried about Steven Jackson, the running back, because of his injury. And they teed off on Bradford, got seven sacks, hit him a bunch of other times. That poor guy, you know, they just think David Carr, the first pick in the draft for the Houston Texans years ago, he spent his entire career there running for his life and really never materialized as a quarterback because of it.
Good day for Chris Cooley. He's now tied with Mike Ditka. Did you know that?
Wow.
18th on the tight end career list.
That's rare air.
That is.
Good for Cooley.